Good morning. How does it feel to serve the only real living God?
Amen.
Amen. Can we all stand and join in our first song?
Yeah.
be seated. I want to welcome everyone out here this morning. Welcome our visitors and all those watching from home. We have a little bit of a different program this morning, so I ask the girls to come up and
shine among us, His glory revealed, living in you. So, the song we're going to sing is a very old song. It was written in the 1800s. And it's a person telling about their dream. And the first verse, they're talking about Palm Sunday, Jesus' entrance. And then the second verse, it tells about the crucifixion. And the third verse is about the person is entering into heaven. They're dreaming of coming into the holy city, and that's the name of the song.
Last night I lay asleeping, there came a dream so I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing. Dream was changed, the streets no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery, the morn was cold and chill, as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, hark how the angels sing, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King.
Once again, the scene was changed. New earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets. The gates were open wide, and not pass away. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, sing, for the night is o'er. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna forevermore. Hosanna
Good morning. Happy Easter. He is risen.
He is risen.
Amen. Some of you might remember this song from about 30 years ago. Sandy Patty was at a morning like this.
Was it a morning like this? When the sun still hid from Jerusalem, and Mary rose from her bed to tend the Lord she thought was dead. Was it a morning like this? When Mary walked down from Jerusalem, and two stood at the tomb, bearers of news she would hear soon. Did the grass seem Did the earth rejoice to feel you again? Over and over, like a trumpet underground, did the earth seem to bound? He had risen. Over and over, in a never-ending round, he is risen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Was it a morning like this when Peter and John ran from Jerusalem? And as they raced toward the tomb, beneath their feet was there a tomb. Did the grass sing? Did the earth rejoice to feel you again?
Y'all stand and join me in prayer, please. Our precious Heavenly Father, we come to you on this morning that we celebrate your rising from the dead, God. You conquered death. You beat the devil once again, God. And we know that through you and with you, we can do anything. Be with this service today and everyone here. And anyone that doesn't have you in their hearts, may they find you before they go home today. In your name, amen. Be seated.
tried by sinful man, torn and beaten, then nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin. The ground beneath quakes as its maker bows his head. The curtain torn in two, the dead are raised to life. Finished the victory cry. This the power. Oh,
Maybe. There we go. So before I sing this, I would like to invite you to join me in whatever way you feel led. I want you to stand and sing, sit and sing, stand and not sing, and you can kneel and sing or not sing. But this is a powerful song, and I know that you know it. You probably sung it before. So please, as you feel led, stand or sit and join me. Love everyone.
It's nearly 10 o'clock at night. The sun set hours ago, and most families are getting ready for bed or already asleep. After all, there aren't many sources of light or fuel to fend off the dark after sundown. A few shadows move quickly and quietly across the street, staying in the dark. After a quick scan to make sure no one else is out, they silently open a door, step in, and immediately shut it behind them. Someone checks to ensure the cloth is tight around the window, while another lights a small candle and mostly covers it. As the darkness is pushed back, A small group of men and women flash each other warm smiles as they huddle closely together. One whispers a prayer. They softly, almost inaudibly, sing several melodies. A few people pull out portions of a Bible from their inner pocket and give it to the only literate one in the group. He respectfully reads a portion. One woman closes her eyes as she hears inspired words. Another holds back tears as it's been over a month since he is able to meet with this precious group of believers. Finally, someone prays a quiet prayer. Smiles are shared again before the candle is extinguished. One by one, these silent shadows slip out of the house and quietly back into their own homes. All evidence of the gathering is erased, and those portions of the Bible wrapped and hidden back under the floor or behind the wall again. Due to severe oppression, this is a norm for Christians among the Oshari. Possessing a Bible can land a person in jail. Claiming to follow Jesus can lead to hard labor or even death. Among the nearly 30 million Oshari, it's estimated that only over 1% are Christian, which makes them an unreached people group. Despite intense persecution, the church is not extinguished. During the worst of COVID, many Oshari lost their lives due to inadequate medical services. However, Christians courageously prayed with their ailing neighbors, and God answered some of those prayers. Not only are there now new brothers and sisters because of that, non-Christians even started looking for black market Bibles to keep as good luck charms, even though having them may mean imprisonment. God is on the move. Last year, the Lord of the Harvest invited UB Global to be a part of bringing his kingdom to the Oshari people. A missionary candidate is preparing to work among Oshari refugees in a nearby country while learning the language and culture. In the future, there may be opportunities for her to serve in the Oshari homeland too. As we begin work among the Oshari, we are learning by attending gatherings. We're empowering and sending the new missionary. We're mobilizing others to join the work, and we're partnering on practical projects with organizations focused on the Oshari. This Easter, will you be a part of bringing new life to a place characterized by oppression? Will you help to financially resource a new missionary, UB Global, and projects with Oshari-serving organizations? Will you join us in piercing one of the darkest places on earth with the light of the world? May the gospel be resurrected in this land.
It's hard to believe in this day and age that there's actually a country somewhere on this world that only 1% of the people have ever heard of Jesus Christ. Things that we take for granted here, oh, we can go to church, we can do this. They could be killed for doing that. So we're taking up a special offering this morning to try and help them out. There's an envelope in your bulletin. If you have a couple extra dollars, stick it in there, and maybe we can help bring God to another country. Also, I want to thank Tom Glessner and Amy, and I don't know who all helped, but they put together the garden up there. It's beautiful. If you haven't had a chance to look at it, go up there after the service and check it out. Pratt's Nursery donated the plants, and thanks to everyone that bought flowers in memory of someone. You can pick them up after church. And that's all I'm going to talk about this morning. Always one. David, you come up here and start us off again.
Morning. its name on high. Lord, I'll not sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
Jesus over you, in your hurting, in your sorrows, I will ask my God to move. I speak the name 'cause it's all that I can do. In desperation, I'll seek heaven and pray this for you. I pray that your healing, the circumstances would change. Pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough would happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. I speak the name of all authority, declaring blessings, every promise he is faithful to keep. I speak the name no grave can ever hold. He is greater, he is stronger, he's the God of possible. I pray that your healing, the circumstances will change. Oh, come believe. circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough would happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name. I pray for revival, restoration of faith. I pray that the dead will come alive in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
When I think of the cross, I think of the insults and the mockery that came from the crowd. I think of a painful 39 lashes and the excruciating pain from a thorn-filled crown. When I think of the cross, I think of brutal suffering and the ultimate sacrifice that Jesus willingly stepped into. You see, the greatest act of love is for the innocent to stand in place for the guilty. And that's exactly what Jesus did when he stood in place for you and me. It's what we call grace. And in a moment of grace, far beyond anything that we could ever comprehend, Jesus took on all our anger, all our anxiety, all our brokenness, all our pain, all our past, every single mistake, all our shame. He took on all the things that we try to carry, but they're just so heavy. But Jesus didn't come just to simply take those things. He came to give us freedom. Because of him, you're no longer lost to your past. Because of him, you're no longer a slave to your shame. Because of him, you're no longer a prisoner to your pain. Because of him, you're no longer bound to your sin. Because of Jesus, we can actually take these things and lay them down at the foot of the cross. See, God's love has liberated us, you and me. Free to forever walk in the light of his amazing grace.
Well, good morning, church family. How are we doing this morning? All right, so you guys need to track with me. If coming to First UB Church on Easter Sunday is a new thing for you, we're going to do something that is kind of an old tradition in churches on Easter Sunday. I'm going to say, he is risen, and the church's response will be, he is risen indeed, except we don't mutter it like we're on the ninth hole of a golf course. We actually exclaim it like we are excited to know that Jesus did raise again from the dead. So he has risen. Amen. Amen. What a fantastic morning. Amen. It's so great to have you with us this morning. It's so great to have families come together. A powerful morning with music and a powerful morning with just amazing songs. I would just want to extend, reiterate what Bill said a little bit earlier, just a huge heart of gratitude for those that have helped out with the resurrection service this morning. Those of you sang special music, thank you so much. I also want to recognize the unsung heroes in the back that just been sweating bullets all morning long trying to make everything happen from the production. And guys, thank you so much in the back. You guys did awesome this morning. managing microphones and trying to flip between TV screens and everything else like that. They do it well, making sure that lyrics are up there. You guys didn't see it, but almost all of the songs this morning, we had lyrics on the backside of the screen. They had to know which screens to turn off. It was just awesome to be able to watch them back there, and so much fun to see them just serving well. I also want to say thanks, Tom and Amy. You guys outdid yourselves this year, and so this is absolutely beautiful. I'd venture to guess, I'd venture to guess that not only are we the only church in Crawford County, but Venango County, Mercer County, Lawrence County, all of these counties around us, I probably would venture to guess that we're probably the only church statewide that has something like this in the front of their sanctuary in order to be able to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so, guys, I want to say thanks so much. You guys outdid yourselves, and it's absolutely, absolutely beautiful. So last but not least, I want to say thanks. If you were here for the Easter sunrise service and your bellies are full from the breakfast, it was there this morning. If you're not, you're hungry, your own fault, not mine. We provided breakfast this morning, got to get out of bed a little bit earlier. But I want to say thanks to the whole entire hospitality team that served well there. It takes a village to raise a child, and it takes a village to do church. That's we are a community for a reason, people serving with their gifts and their talents. And so thank you for that amazing breakfast, and thank you for all that you guys did for the Passover feast this past week too. So I have a question for you. Why does the cross matter? Why does the resurrection matter? What's the big deal? What did Jesus do that deserves our attention? And not just our attention, but our affections also. These are just some of the questions that the resurrection of Jesus Christ does demand for each of us to answer. And when I mean answer, being passive aggressive and not answering it is still an answer. So the reality of Christ being crucified, Christ being raised from the dead, demands that we answer in one way or another. And so, I'm sorry, Mr. President, your announcement yesterday is an abomination. I don't know whether you caught it on the news, but it was nothing short of an abomination. The resurrection of Jesus Christ will not be shared, will not be overshadowed, and it will not be forgotten. Amen. Our attention, church, our affections as Christians should never be anywhere but on Christ's victory on the cross and his triumphant resurrection. Nowhere else. So I have a story to kind of help us lean into today's message and answer some of those questions. On May 21st, 1946, I've heard it was a good year. It was just a little bit before I was born. My dad was 4 and my mom was 1. So it was in Los Alamos, New Mexico. A young and daring scientist was carrying out a necessary experiment in preparation for the atomic test to be conducted in the waters in South Pacific. In his effort to determine the amount of U-235 necessary for a chain reaction, he would push two hemispheres of uranium together in the experiment. And then, just as the masses became critical and were about to explode, he would push them back apart with a screwdriver. Does that catch you kind of weird? Like, that doesn't really seem all that meticulously scientific at all, but back in 1942, that's as scientific as you could get with that experiment. Thus, in pulling them back apart, instantly stopping the chain reaction. Even though the young scientist has successfully performed this experiment many times before, something went terribly wrong on May 21st, 1946. As the material became critical that day, as they became closer and closer together, the screwdriver that would initially be inserted in between the cells and pulling them back apart slipped. The hemispheres of uranium came too close together. Instantly, the room was filled with a dazzling bluish haze that day. Young Lewis Slotin, instead of ducking and thereby possibly saving himself, tore the two hemispheres apart literally with his hands and consequently interrupted the chain reaction. From his instant heroic act, he saved the lives of seven other people in the room that day. And as he waited for the car to take him to the hospital, he said quietly to his companions, "You'll come through this all right, but I haven't the faintest of chances." It's true, 9 days later, he died in agony. Before Jesus came to earth, mankind was contaminated by the deadly uranium called sin. Jesus heroically stepped in at the right time, in the nick of time, and saved mankind from spiritual destruction. And he died on the cross to free us from our sins. Romans chapter 5, verses 7 through 9 says, "Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though a good person, someone might dare to die. But God demonstrated his own love for us while we were still sinners. Christ died for us." And that's not an us out there. That's a me. That's a you personally. That's not an us in generality. That is you specific. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? 1 John chapter 4, verse 10 nails this down even a little bit tighter. It says, "This is real love. Not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as a sacrifice to take away our sins." That is what Easter is about. How Jesus had no regard for his own well-being because of you. Jesus lived his life methodically, purposefully, well planned out, guided by the Holy Spirit, and directed by God in heaven. Jesus lived his life from the first day to the very last day here on earth with one thing on his mind. You know what that was? You. Me. Loving you so much that he took on your sins and died the death that you and I should have because he loves you. The cross reminds me he loves me more than he loves his own life. This having no regard for his own well-being, by definition, makes him reckless. Reckless, by definition, let me be clear, is of a person or their actions pertaining specifically to that. And it says this, without thinking, that's not true. That's why that word "or" in this definition is so absolutely crucial. Because Jesus was methodical in everything that he did. It was planned out that he would follow his Father's will. That's why, like I said, this word "or" is so important. Caring about the consequences of an action. He had no regard for the consequences of the actions in which he was going to do. And so, as I said, this doesn't mean that Jesus' plan for his death and resurrection wasn't methodical or planned out at all. It simply means that the cost he would pay to rescue you from an eternity in hell wouldn't have and couldn't have stopped him from dying on the cross. Can you say amen to that? There was nothing in all of eternity, nothing in heaven and hell, nothing on earth that was going to stop Jesus from fulfilling the Father's will and dying in your place because he loves you. The personal cost, the personal consequences were of no matter for him. The cross shows us that Jesus cares more about you than he does for himself. In fact, Hebrews chapter 4 tells us that there was much joy in Jesus' heart, laying down his life and taking up the cross, because it was the Father's will for him. And then in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 through 8, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his advantage. You ever tried to do that at work? Name drop? Just to get ahead? To get one up? I mean, Jesus could have dropped who his dad was at any point in time he wanted to. And that's kind of like the trump card of all trump cards, right? I mean, how do you drop a bigger name than the creator of the entire cosmos? I mean, put that on your resume. And I think everybody would be pretty persuaded. But he didn't see that his sonship with God was something that he should ever take advantage of. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. And that means even before that Jesus came here to earth, Jesus knew his destiny was to take your punishment for your sin. He knew he abandoned his place in heaven, sitting down his crown, literally put on flesh, and with an unstoppable will, lived to die one day on the cross to pay for the sins of the entire world. Your sins and my sins. And Christ's statement in John chapter 15, verse 13, sums up it really well. There is no greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend. Jesus demonstrated this boundless love over and over again, but the climax of that was what he was willing to do on that cross for you and for me. Jesus literally laid down his own life for his friends and those who would obey him. But that's not the entirety of this story. He even laid down his life for those that physically hung him on that cross that day. He did the unfathomable. He laid down his life for his enemies. Those that were persecuting him, those that were mocking him, those that were beating him, those that had whipped him, those that had spat in his face, those that had punched him. And why? Simply this. You and I, it's so we could have eternal life with him in heaven instead of eternal life separated from him in hell. He exhibited the most remarkable display of love when he died for our sins, showing us what true selfless love looks like. Jeffrey Bull wrote in his book called God Holds the Key. He says this: who can fathom the immeasurable cost to Christ of meeting all of the necessities of the plan for atonement? In other words, who can figure out the immeasurable cost that Christ paid that day when he laid down his life and paid the penalty for your sin? He who would purge our sin must himself be made sin, ere we could stand accepted in his righteousness. He would be our peace must first become accursed. We could be at one with God because of that. He who would be our joy must first be a man of sorrow. He could bring us singing into the courts above. As the mediator, he must die to bring us into his inheritance. A minister of the sanctuary, he must need to be touched by the feelings of our infirmities and maintain us in the house of God with and by and through his blood. All his life on earth, from the first day to the last, in all of its moment and all of its places, was utterly controlled by the need to die in the perfect appointment of God for you, because he loves you more than he loved his own life. In John chapter 18, a passage that I had reflected on sitting here on Friday afternoon, or Saturday afternoon when we were here, or Friday afternoon when we were here for the garden. And in this passage, I was reflecting on Jesus' interaction. He had already had the Last Supper with his disciples. He had already been on trial all through the night, and they could not figure out the Sanhedrin, the religious leaders in those days. They had their own court system. They couldn't figure out how to literally make any charges stick against Jesus. And so they drug him to Pilate, the guy that was the head of the government in the area. And in this interaction in John chapter 8, we come to understand Pilate tried everything humanly possible, everything that he could, to get Jesus released. finding no fault, he even says in front of the crowd. He considered, he conceded to the demands of the religious elite and paid protesters. Yes, it was the religious elite and paid protesters in those days. You thought that was something new. It was not. They were paid protesters, religious elite, wanting to crucify Jesus. And I don't really want to send the innocent man to death. That would be Pilate's stance. But I don't want a riot on his hand, because if there's a riot on my hands, then Caesar's going to come down hard on me. And he's like, that's not a good situation. So he tried to bribe them. Do you want Jesus from Nazareth, or do you want Bar-Jesus, the insurrectionist? And the crowd shouted loudly to the dismay, the unbelief of Pilate. They shouted, give us Jesus, crucify him. Crucify him. In other words, the crowd was so incited with anger that day that they were willing to give somebody that was noted for multiple insurrections in those days, giving that person freedom while Christ would be crucified. Not even bribing the crowd with a well-known criminal could save Jesus from the cross that day. He abandoned who he was in heaven and he came to earth to die on the cross. And I'm thankful Jesus knew the cost and was willing to be persuaded that it was not being willing to change his trajectory to that cross. There was absolutely nothing. Craig Larson gives us this illustration of what Christ did for us on the cross. There was a newspaper article in the Chicago Tribune on June 22nd, 1997. It was a parachute instructor, Michael Costello. He was 42. Of Mount Dora, Florida, jumped out of an airplane at 12,000 feet in altitude with a novice skydiver named Garth Griffith, age 21. The novice would soon discover how good his instructor was, for his parachute failed when the novice pulled the ripcord. Plummeting towards the ground, he faced certain death. But then the instructor did an amazing thing. Just before he hit the ground, the instructor rolled over so that he would hit the ground first, and the novice would be on top of him. The instructor was killed instantaneously as he hit the ground. The novice fractured his spine in the fall, but was not paralyzed. One man takes the place of another and takes the brunt for another. One substitutes himself to die so another may live. So it was with Christ when Jesus died for our sins so that we might live forever. So why does Easter matter? What did Jesus do that deserves our affection and our attention? Once again, Romans chapter 5, verse 8. God demonstrated in the cross his love for us in this: while we were incapable of doing anything about our sins, Christ rolled over and took on our sin. I don't know about you, but I'm glad Christ rolled over that day. In that last minute, and he took on my death, the death that I deserved. But that wasn't the end of the story. 3 days later, as it was foretold by the prophets, hundreds of years before Jesus' birth, he would defy all odds and rise from the dead. So why does Easter matter? Why does the resurrection matter? Because if the resurrection did not happen, without it, our faith would be dead. But Jesus is alive. And let me leave you with four proofs of Jesus' resurrection. Lee Strobel, an author that I'm very familiar with, talks about these four proofs of the resurrection. But what you need to understand about who Lee Strobel was is that at one point in time in his life, he set out to absolutely destroy, dismantle, and destruct the gospel of Jesus Christ. And in his research to disprove the Bible, Christianity, Christ, death, and resurrection, he came face to face with a living Jesus. And the overwhelming proof of his existence and his resurrection. Here is what Lee says about the proofs that we have of his resurrection. Jesus was dead. Did Jesus die on the cross? That's a lot of people. No, he just passed out. They thought he was dead and they brought his body down. Here's what he says. Virtually every scholar on planet Earth concedes that Jesus was dead after the crucifixion. Did you know this? There is not one single historical record anywhere or of anyone ever surviving a full Roman crucifixion. Not one. That kind of slims down the odds of him actually dying on the cross, right? Did you, so even the Journal of American Medical Association says clearly the weight of evidence indicates that Jesus was dead even before the wound to his side was inflicted. If that wasn't enough, there are New Testament atheists. Gerard Ludemann says this, historically, it is indisputable that Jesus was dead. Indisputable. Number two, the second proof that we have to know that the resurrection truly happened. Early accounts from the resurrection. Like myself, maybe you grew up in a situation where, like my kids, were taught in public schools that the resurrection of Jesus Christ in Christianity is nothing more than a legend, a fable, a bad indigestion at times. And it took a long time to develop the narrative we have right now before us about the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But this simply is not the case. I have learned that we have preserved a creed even from literally months after Christ's death that was from the first century believers. And scholars have dated it back, like I said, within even months of his death on the cross. Talk about historical gold. Undisputable evidence. Number three, the empty tomb. This one blows me away. Even those that opposed Jesus openly admitted that the tomb was empty. When the disciples came about and said that he had risen, all of the opponents said that the disciples stole the body. The resurrection did happen, and they weren't denying that. But I find it really, really interesting that they conceded the tomb was empty, but make up some type of fairy tale about the group of fishermen and a tax collector and a doctor, how somehow they overpowered at least 12 Roman soldiers that were trained killers. I don't understand the logic behind that. Maybe you can figure it out because you're smarter than I am. You can talk to me after the service this morning, but that sounds kind of irrational and stupid, doesn't it? That's the proof of the cross. That's the proof of the resurrection. How the empty tomb got empty is the real question, and that brings us to the fourth category of evidence. There were eyewitnesses. What baffles me is that many will take the one word or two words from somebody that they don't even know, that they don't even know whether they should trust, they don't even know their credentials, and they'll take on their opinion because it fits their narrative, their way of living. But when it comes to something like Christianity, something like the crucifixion of Christ and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, those same people will deny the mountain of literal evidence of the resurrection. Did you know that there are no less than 9 ancient sources inside the scripture and outside of the scriptures, the New Testament, confirming and corroborating that the disciples encountered the risen Christ? Not just inside the scriptures, but outside of the scriptures. That's an avalanche of historical data. But yet we'll take the opinion of some Joe Schmo on the street corner that has absolutely no credentials, and we'll take their narrative and we'll agree to it because it fits my narrative. And yet we'll ignore all of the evidence of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Like the song Alive by Big Daddy Weave says, "But God, rich in mercy, you came to save me. Now I'm alive. But God, strong and mighty, you reached down for me so I could rise. Now I'm alive. For those that put their trust in Jesus Christ, the cross says you are forgiven and you are radically loved. And the resurrection of Jesus Christ shows us we have been given new life. If you have never taken on the invitation that Jesus is extending today to be forgiven from your sins, the invitation to new life, let today be the day. Stop letting anonymous people from newscasts and articles sway you from the amount of evidence that is literally sitting at your feet today. The evidence that says the cross and the empty grave means God loves me. If you have never put your trust in Jesus, would you do that today? If you have drifted from Jesus, let Easter of 2024 be the day that you let Christ back into your life. As the worship team comes forward to lead us in one final song, I believe God has been speaking to some here today, or maybe some even listening online at home. And you're tired of running. You're tired of running from Jesus. I want to invite you to come running to him today. While you surrender your life to Jesus, will you surrender your life to Jesus? Will you come running to his open arms once again and experience his love fresh and anew today? This isn't a gimmick. This isn't a long plea this morning, but I'm going to ask you right now. I'm just going to ask all eyes to be up, just your attention on me this morning. And if that's you, I want to trust in Jesus Christ for the very first time. Can you just look me straight in the eyes and shake your head like this? That's me. I want to trust Jesus for the very first time. Or maybe you're distant from him today. You've been running from him. You've been playing the kind of the Christian American thing. But yet Jesus, it really hasn't changed much in your life. He hasn't changed you from the inside out. And today the Holy Spirit's stirring in your heart and going, today's the day. Instead of running from Jesus, I'm going to come running to, instead of running from him, I'm going to come running to him. If that's you today, just look at me right now. If that's you today and you want to recommit your life to Christ, then let's do it right here and right now. Stop listening to the nonsense that is spewed by the media in the world out there, and people that you don't even know. I find it really, really weird that we will trust sources that we don't know who they are, and we can't even remember where the information came from. But yet, when we're presented with a mountain of evidence that's in the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he loves you more than you could ever imagine, that's why he went to the cross, that's why he rose again, we just disregard it. And I'll tell you why it happens. I'll tell you why it happens. Because there's something rising up in you that just says, not yet. Not yet. I'm going to hold off until I can get my life together. And Jesus says, come to me weary and weak, and I'll give you rest. If you trust me with your life, I'll take that burden that you're holding on to, thinking that that's what needs to happen in your life. I will take that away from you. Come to me. Trust me today. If I can die on the cross and raise from the dead, then I'm pretty sure I can take care of all of your needs today and tomorrow and the next day after that. Will you trust Jesus today? Whether you've never invited him into your heart and said, Jesus, would you forgive me? Would you come into my life? Make it Easter Sunday 2024. Make it today that you settle that and you change your eternity from hell to a home in heaven where your Father will greet you with arms wide open and say, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into your eternal rest. Maybe you've been running from Christ and you're like, my legs are tired. I'm tired of carrying this on my own. Jesus, today I'm coming to you. I'm yours. Would you stand with me as we sing one last song?
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. The morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till the stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born when the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not fade. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Arose and said, amen. Amen and amen. Have an amazing resurrection day. Love you, church.